5:30, so we will get started. This is our monthly Transfer Station Building Committee meeting, and it's Wednesday, even though it feels like February 16th, it's April 16th, and we're chairing. And we have with us today, tonight, we're televised, and we have Ann Saunders from Sharon is here tonight. Ann, nice to see you.
Thanks.
And we have a reporter from...
Lakeville Journal.
Lakeville Journal. Did I miss anybody else? Okay. And so we'll get started. Did everyone get to see the copy of the report of the meeting with the town, with the staff, with the transfer station? Everybody got that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. There's a lot of information. Good. Okay. Could we have a motion to approve the agenda for this evening?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Approved. Could we approve the motion to approve the minutes of the March 19th, 2014 meeting?
So moved.
Any additions, corrections, changes?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Approved. We've done three things since we met last. One was our trip to Hartford. That was between the last meeting and this one, right? Could we do that? Yeah, after that. So those that went on that know that it was a great trip, and we all learned a lot, I think, and saw. I think it makes sense if we understand where everything goes and we can put visualize what it looks like. So we did do that, but then also, hi Charlie.
Hi Charlie.
And also we had the walk around of the new fitting property, which was very beneficial.
That's fine.
And Bob and Kevin Grindle met with the staff at the transfer station. So I think we did some worthwhile, important things in the last 30 days, three separate things that I think help us all understand and do a better job. So did anyone have any comments before we get into this about the trip to Hartford and the transfer station we visited? That was just very interesting, and I think it was very beneficial. But
we can discuss that at the track meeting more than that in more detail.
Okay, great. Okay. We got a lot to cover tonight. We're going to be short on time, so we'll just move along. Then the walk around of the loop fitting property, it was an eye-opener for me. I had looked at that, but not very, very closely. The posts being there, the markers, Kevin, were excellent. Helped me visualize what's going to go where. Bob, did you want to cover that at this meeting somewhat, and in your meeting at the transfer station with the...
No, that's your... No, the walk around and the report of the meeting for this meeting. We wouldn't discover that. You want me to discuss?
Sure. Would you want to, since you were there for that, could you kind of review that for us?
The walk around, right?
Sure, the walk around and then the meeting with the...
Okay. I think we'll let
staff.
Kevin do the meeting with...
Okay.
The walk around, I think I think a lot of us, I was out there a number of years ago to go out and look at it, was really beneficial. I think Kevin found a few things when you were out there, and you may want to speak to this, to cutting into that tree line as a meeting with the staff. I don't think it was in there, but a barrier that was depicted on the plans, as one of the staff members said, that's basically dead. You might as well cut it down. And so that when we went out and looked at it physically, I think you agree that you can cut into that, and that frees up more space and allows us to do some things that we might not otherwise. The other thing I think that was important to me, which doesn't show up anywhere, it wouldn't on the minutes, is as Charlie talked about at one of the meetings, the wind, and it may have been just that day, but the wind on that site coming in from the west, is it?
Yes.
Is pretty severe. It was an eye opener for me, which tells me we have to.
Wind screening is important.
Yeah, wind screening, I think, close up rather than out by the compost area is an important thing.
So it's not every day, it's like a couple days a week, maybe.
That can blow a lot of bags and styrofoam around fairly quickly.
So,
And also snow.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, good point.
So I think that's, unless anyone else.
No, that was good. You mentioned it was eye-opener for me. I enjoyed it. And it reinforced the fact that, to me, that we're way back in the road. I think location-wise, we're in great shape. And I know we're committed to make minimal changes as far as, or to affect the area in a minimal way, and I don't think we will. I think we're going to be fine there. We're certainly shielded, and we're back enough, we're far enough back in the road. Yes, Malcolm?
I was impressed by what would appear to be the amount of fill that's going to be necessary to level the site off, although, you know, an exact amount of cubic yards was not discussed, but it's a pretty good slope, and it goes on for a fairly good distance.
Yeah, one thing, though, in regard to that, you know, there is ledge close to the ground, as Kevin pointed out. There is a lot of fill required. If you know our current site, I think probably in the center of the site, Brian, correct if I'm wrong, is probably a foot to ledge.
I have no idea.
Okay, a foot and a half to ledge.
It's pretty close.
It's pretty close. Yeah. So we dealt with this in 1976. It's virtually no different than what we dealt with in 1976. The only difference is we don't have the Hammertown gravel bank as a source of gravel now. But these conditions are not insurmountable. We dealt with it in 76, and so I don't see them much different than site conditions than what we dealt with. And I think that was a tree property in 76, required clearing. So these things are not catastrophic to me. Because we've already been over this territory once before, so very successfully, I will say.
No, I agree. And Malcolm, yeah, it's got to be level, or pretty level, mm-hmm. and we got to get rid of that slope. So yeah, it's just another one of the challenges that we've got to deal with.
But we did it.
Yeah.
76. So.
Right, we'll do it. We will do it. Great. So, any other comments on the walkthrough on that? Everyone have any questions on what we did? Yes, Brian.
Just more for Kevin. Sorry, I was late, very late. Everybody had left except for Kevin, Bob, and Curtis when I got there. Anything on the three-phase power out on the street?
Nothing on the three-phase power yet. Okay. I do have a couple things to add as far as the sidewalk, so if this segues into that.
Go ahead, do that, and then just go into your room.
Perfect. As Bob had indicated first, as far as the clearing limits, we were maintaining the existing limits based upon that sidewalk. We've been able to take advantage of quite a bit of that northerly buffer, remove some trees and stay out of the steepest slope area as we go to the west. So I've got plans here that I'll distribute as part of this discussion, some incorporating ideas that we discussed with staff, some based upon the sidewalk. And it's really just the next level of discussion here. So I'll segue to that, and then I can kind of, I will also email those out. As far as the sidewalk is concerned, again, the vegetation, something that we did look at the end, be it myself, Bob, and Brian, was the sight lines on Middleton. We've discussed those before. What we had done, or what Anchor had done historically, was identify the four locations of access on Middleton, being the existing abandoned driveway on that house, the existing driveway that we use for the sidewalk, and then up to Diamond Road and the existing driveway up on the house in the corner. So we've got sight lines, surveyed sight lines from those four locations based upon our site walk out on Middleton and the conversation that we had earlier. It does appear that if we shift west, it's somewhere in the order of 50 to 75 feet. The sight line does or appears to improve if we do reorient that driveway slightly. All along in the plans, I've carried a note that final driveway location will be based upon the ideal sight line and conversation with the Department of Transportation, the DOT District 4 office. So we do have the opportunity to shift there. One concern is a utility pole in that location. We can move about 45 feet until we get to that utility pole and then have to have the conversation whether the sight lines improve dramatically enough to go to the extent of relocating that utility pole or not. But we do have flexibility for where we come out on Middleton in that area. The clearing sight lines, What I can do, I can transition into my report of meeting, go through some of those items, and then circle back around as far as the revised plan is concerned. That meeting with staff, with Ryan and his staff, was about 2 hours long and was very, very informative and needed for this process. So what I tried to do here is bullet everything that we discussed with any depth. Really, most of his staff was very in tune with their needs as far as daily operations and the needs of the residents. So the majority of these, be it starting with the traffic patterns, parking has been an issue all along, and then moving through into some of the building items, and then finally into the operations. What you do see here is, as you go through, all these are really above and beyond what's currently shown in the plan. Some of these here we discussed incorporating into the plan as far as anything that would be easily or conceptually adjusted. And then there were some of the larger items, more configuration items that we would be shifting and looking into. So as far as just some of the immediate items that we discussed, obviously we've talked about the traffic parking issues and the need for a positive traffic flow through this site. Visiting with Ryan for a couple of hours, that's obviously very apparent on the existing site, and it's something that we can incorporate, and some of these revisions have been looked at as far as getting people into parking locations the best we can so that there's the least confusion on site. So as we go through here, my caveat on top, these construction items, we haven't put pricing to at this point. It's really a matter of, what we need from this committee is now an action item as far as how many of these things we incorporate and how we proceed with them. Obviously, some of the parking configurations, some of the traffic patterns, those are relatively easy to integrate because it's a conversation that we've had, continually as far as how can we improve. But when it does, when we move into some of the items on, under buildings and then the operations and maintenance, some of those carry with them price tags that we need to be comfortable with. I say we, effectively the building committee needs to be comfortable with whether they're going to be incorporated at this time, planned for at this time for future construction, or if it's something that you're not interested in pursuing. Those are items that we need to know from, before we move much further. Some of the items specifically as far as the main office, the needs of the main office, the size of the main office, a lot of this comes back to scale as far as what will be occurring on site, what will be occurring in that office. Something very simple as, are we going to accept tickets or are we going to be accepting money for the passes or so on. Is the SSRIA going to be functioning out of that office? It's something that, if it's purely a scale house, it can be an 8x10, portable scale house. However, we've been showing all along a 24x36 building that will be containing bathrooms and offices and storage space. So again, it's that scale issue of what are we trying to accomplish. Some of the items.
I'm sort of on the first page still.
Yes.
Is that okay to just...
Stop me at any point.
Okay, item number four.
Yes.
We had... access drive drives relocated. Oh, there was one item here about trucks coming in off of Diamond.
Yes, number nine.
Number nine, I'm sorry.
Yep.
Yeah. I never thought of that at all. One, is that... And I know we've had a lot of concern about trucks versus cars and that kind of thing. I mean, is that, anyone else thought of that? Or, I mean, is this kind of a new thing to me? Is that something we could do without a lot of trouble? And what effect would that have on the traffic flow?
That is something that we can pursue further. The couple caveats I do have in that is the ownership of Diamond Road.
Right.
Our
going to say.
Exactly. The original survey that we've been basing our work off of does provide two notes on that survey indicating that Diamond Road was discontinued. However, with the town, owning property adjacent to Diamond Road, there is typically and should be a right to access. However, with that being a discontinued road, that needs to be assured before we pursue that.
Mike, go back. Luke Fitting Committee looked into this issue because, I don't know if you're aware, the Lee property was further down on Diamond Road. So we looked at that access, and I can't remember all the details. I know there is a bottleneck down there where the right-of-way, there is a right-of-way down through there. And you're right, we probably have a right to access.
Okay.
There is a bottleneck down there someplace, I think it's in front of the Luke House, where the right-of-way narrows. And that was one of the issues. Okay. And that's where the concern, the concerns with the Lee property, what were we going to do? We're going to have to do a taking or buy a part of that. So that was, and I don't know where that is compared to where we might want to gain access.
It's further down.
Because I thought that we weren't going to use that, but I didn't know why. I just thought, but I do that, the fact that it might help with traffic flow, and if there aren't houses that we would disturb much on the end, I'm not sure without knowing much about it. But
it could, that could be an opportunity. I will say that providing, you know, currently the plan showing a 36-foot wide access drive off of Milliton as a primary access, to be perfectly honest with you, that should suffice as far as trucks, traffic, and traffic flow. Diamond Road is just a nice, you know, a nice discussion point and could be, you know, could be looked into further if we really needed to, or if, you know, if the operators, if Brian was to say, you know, this is really something that this committee or the town should look into, it does provide an opportunity.
But doesn't it have a poor sight line though?
That's what I was going to say. Did you consider the sight line there?
Yeah, and we did look at that sight line. Diamond Road is in fact not a bad sight line.
It's a good sight line.
Yeah, it's a good sight line compared to, you know, we get much worse as the further west we go. So our access drive is really on the westerly limit, you know, that plus or minus 40 to 50 feet as I was discussing. But Diamond Road is a pretty good sight line.
Do you feel, though, that we could eliminate this concern with commercial and then residents without using Diamond Road? We have enough.
I believe it's enough width on our access drive, and to provide one point of entrance, I believe the access drive we're showing off Milliton would be the best location.
Okay.
Diamond Road would be a second choice.
It seems as though it would be cleaner having one access drive.
Yes, it would. Mm-hmm. Yes, it would. If there needed to be an emergency access or a fire access or some ancillary access, you could very well put, a security gate to Diamond gate, yeah, and have a, you know, have an entrance there, but use it, intermittently or for emergency purposes.
I think shopping carts is a good idea too. Never thought of that, but I think that's a great idea. If people want to park a little bit away and just bring it in. Ed, yes.
Which, wouldn't it require a fairly substantial expenditure to upgrade Diamond Road enough?
Yes.
For truck traffic.
It's very muddy there too.
Yeah.
In the spring.
Yeah.
We have to bring in a lot of big stone for a base, yeah, if you're going,
right,
to
and,
do truck traffic.
And if you're going to do trucks, for part of the year you would need lights, so you'd have to run poles back there, which obviously would add to the expense,
yeah,
of doing
so. And then the other question we had when we were talking about is who maintains plows and salts or sands, yeah, Diamond Road?
You're running into a lot of ongoing expenses, yeah, when you add another road.
Well, why don't we kind of leave that as a plan B and stick with
it? It was only things that were put out.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's a discontinued town road, so that's really a private road to the residents of the Loop property, right? They're the only ones down there now, is that correct?
No, also, whatchamacallit owns a farm there.
Yeah.
He has a right of way to the house,
right,
that he
forgot
bought down
that
in there.
Okay.
So there's two, they share the right.
Used to be Rossiter's, is it?
Yeah, Rossiter's, the old Rossiter farm, which
Well, on the surface, initially, it sounds as though that would be an expense we don't want to deal with.
The one
that
reason
would be
why,
an added expense.
The one reason why it came up in the discussion was to send our trucks outbound,
right,
up Diamond Road, because it would be on top of the grade,
mm-hmm,
and they would have a better sight line west. That was where that all the
so from a safety standpoint, it makes sense.
Makes sense.
It may be cost prohibitive.
Yeah. And then they wouldn't climb up, and it would eliminate noise in Charlie's neighborhood. and we did Beyond the Road, and we go into Connecticut more than we go west. So that's sort of why that was put on the table.
It's worthy of consideration.
Well, let's just leave it there, because it's something you always call fallback on.
And the thing is, at some point, if it became a problem, we could utilize it.
Well, I think the idea of an emergency way into the back of the facility is a good one to keep in the plan, no matter how, even if it's minimal expense to do it. Just from an emergency point of view, would be good.
Yeah, you can't put a gate on a road. Someone said something about a
right.
gate, because the people live on it.
Right. I mean, you would be turning off that road
yes.
into our gate.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, we need to give our engineer some action plans tonight. Should we start on this list on the first page and go down and approve or eliminate items so he leaves here with an action plan tonight?
I think so.
Okay. Sure.
I would appreciate that.
I think that's a good idea, John. And should we just go down real quickly? Additional parking needed for compactors so that residents can walk their trash to the hoppers rather than waiting in line. Yeah, I think that's a good idea. I think shopping carts are a good idea. And don't everyone agree with this? And then we'll just stop, save on congestion. So that looks like a good idea.
One and two are sort of tied together.
Yeah. Okay. They're a good deal.
We're finding
okay.
that as Tom met with a staff member, met with us at 4:30, because he said it took one gentleman, it may have been exaggerating a little bit, he said 45 minutes to carry two bags over. And if you have a queue, and we're old, Tom, and I don't want to hurry. I don't want the person to hurry and trip and fall. So if it takes him 45 minutes, that's okay. But you can't have a line of 21 cars on Sunday.
Yeah, wait. Yeah.
Yeah. We're going to get. So that's, that really, I think that's top priority.
Yeah, that makes sense.
That makes sense. I think one and two, we say, yes, it makes sense. Three, parking lots need to be removed where possible. I agree, because we're just going to knock them out anyway.
Yeah.
And it's just, they look nice, but we shouldn't.
The only islands that I will remain in there is anything required for stormwater, as far as catch basins
okay.
or inlets. All the rest will remove.
Number four, the driveway to the existing house shouldn't share the same drive. I agree. Do we decide that, and then instead of shooting off of that, we'll have a probably we're going to move a little bit west anyway.
There's an existing abandoned drive there.
Yeah.
If it's your purview. We will propose that reorientation back to that original location. Historically, I don't know how it got from one to another. If there's nobody in the room that says otherwise, I mean, we're perfectly comfortable. It's an existing curb cut on Middleton.
Yeah.
But we can reorient that, and then there wouldn't be any shared access easement requirements.
Okay.
Curtis may be able to touch some. Was that just abandoned when the town bought the property, the original driveway?
No, I think it was abandoned by Mike Finnegan.
Yeah, Mike James, it was.
When he got a chance to go up.
You change it more because it's level up where he moved it. And that was a kind of a steep driveway.
I see.
Okay. If I'm going too fast, and if anyone has any questions, just yell. Okay. Five. We need to have a turnaround outside the gate. Yes, I think we do. In case someone pulls in there, they can't just be stuck. All right. A slide gate would be a lot easier when it snows, wouldn't it, Brian?
Yes.
I don't know what costs are, but it makes sense to me if we could do it.
Slide gates would be more expensive, however feasible in an option like this. Our hesitation would be as far as if there's any remote controls or automatic gates. Honestly, with a low traffic volume, I understand that, the staff's concern was, obviously with people near closing time, it's easier to shut the gate, period, rather than as you walk up to the gate, have somebody sneak in. But that's an additional cost that I'd argue for a slide gate. However, if it was an automatic, I don't think that would be necessary at this time. It's something that we could put conduit in the ground, and if it needed to be energized at a later date, it could be something that, could be done in the future.
Mm-hmm.
But that's something that we can put a price to both options, and that would be one of the ones that could get knocked out,
If the wind's, if the wind's an issue, a slide gate's probably going to be more secure than swinging.
Yeah.
Yes. Much
less cumbersome.
Yeah.
And entrance and egress is the same road, so you couldn't close the delivery was gone anyway. I mean, it's hard to keep people out if there's someone in. The gate's got to be open until they leave.
Close it halfway.
Oh, I don't do, okay, good, I learned something, thank you.
No, that's what you do, if you don't, you're.
Okay.
Yeah, that is spending the night in the transfer station.
Same thing with the fire, but I locked a few folks in there over the years.
So that's a yes on the five, maybe on automatic?
Yes.
Seven, the shopping carts, wagons, good idea, yeah, I think that's great.
I think it's a good idea, but to anybody who's gotten a dinger in a parking lot at a shopping center, because people don't return carts to where they're supposed to be, that's my only caveat on that. It is a good idea, though, especially for older folks to have a way to roll it. And since we're gonna be working with asphalt rather than gravel, it's much more feasible than what we have now.
Yeah, it wouldn't work on gravel, I don't think.
Not so much.
What kind of a shopping cart would fit a garbage can, though?
It'd be a wagon or shopping cart, just an idea, something with wheels.
Almost like at a garden shop where you, you know, if you go to Lowe's or something, you load up.
Yeah.
Something like that.
It's for ease of getting it some distance. We learned that people will travel a distance. They park out by the gate now if they have to and carry their garbage over. And this is just one of those things that we're gonna redesign, that rather than have only two cars dropping off at once, we're gonna, that this is one of those ideas. And this, again, can be added, you know, afterwards.
So we're leaning towards yes, but we'll have to see. But I think it sounds like it, on the surface, it's like it might be a good idea.
And for Kevin's point of view, he doesn't have to worry about that anyway.
Right, no, that's not for him, that's a non-issue.
Well, I drive a piece of junk, so if someone hits a truck.
You do, I noticed that.
Well, do you need to make provisions for pedestrian lane versus, or is there already?
There is already pedestrian lane. One idea, as far as, like Bob said, you know, as far as people walking, it's one of the opportunities that we could provide for less parking immediately at the hopper and provide for more parking nearby, so that you could pull and park and then you're walking, you know, 50 feet.
And what they did up in Lexington, they just did the school, they just put in speed humps, which definitely slows you down the first time you hit it. It comes up about 6 inches, and instead of going down with the handicapped access, they bring the handicapped access up. You go up, over, and back down, and the hump is about 6 feet wide in brick design. Very attractive, but it does slow you down. So if there's traffic there, you're gonna slow down anyway, whether it's someone there or not. And so that could be incorporated in. And I think they are plowing the streets up there in Lexington, so it doesn't interfere with plowing or anything like that. You can't plow at 45 miles an hour. Mm-hmm.
It's a good double use.
Okay. Sir, sure. Can we move on to 8? Are we okay?
Yeah.
The park configuration where you have to back out of the swap shop is a hazard, yes, if it's good backing out into traffic.
And number 8 ties in very well with number 33 on the last page. As far as one item being, we were showing the drive-through for the bulky and the C&D containers. The intent there is to eliminate those drive aisles and allow for backing into that area. So in doing that reconfiguration of the swap shop and so on, that will go away. So number 8 and 33 are connected and can be addressed as one. So that can be taken care of.
Okay, good. 10, an access drive behind the swap shed to allow vehicles a direct route out of the station. I mean, if we could do it. Hi, Bob. If it's possible,
and
yeah.
The intent there was a conversation with Brian as well, as far as providing access back to the scale. You know, after you go through the scales, provide access off the scales to somewhere you can pay. You can you know, stop and park and to pay. So that drive aisle can also be you know, worked in with the operations plan of the scale. So that's doable.
Okay, good. 11. These additional parking needs to be shown at the scale, so the outbound scale users make it out of the traffic flow.
That's
to
the
pay
same
for
thing.
Their load.
Same thing I just mentioned.
Same
yep.
thing. Okay.
Yep. So those two are connected and can be addressed easily.
Okay. All right. Everybody, all right. We're on the buildings. Number 12.
Good job. You're moving it right along. I like your style.
Okay. We'll get her done. Right.
You have, Joe.
12. The main office may be located centrally on the site rather than adjacent to the scale for better view of the compactors, waste containers, along with overseeing traffic flow. Yeah, and I think, didn't you show a better location for that?
That's something that, every time we were talking, we're moving it either closer or further away. So right now, we're moving it closer, and it also ties in well with number 13, as far as, like I said before, what's the intended use of that office? Specifically, we can bring it right up to the compactors if it's just a matter of, you know, an attendant overseeing. But if we're moving it away to sell tickets and be a scale house, then we have to provide, you know, substantial parking, and it's more of a headquarters.
And that, we've got to make a decision on that. We've just got to figure out what we're going to do. Good, and that's so we're up to 14. And I don't know how we're going to answer that until we just do some homework.
I think you have to see a plan.
Yeah, okay. 14 is the same thing pretty much, isn't it?
It's the same thing. It's if we remote the main office, then right. It's a conversation we had with staff as far as providing them a shelter to get out of the weather, and especially get out of the wind and elements, or, you know, that we just got through over the winter, right up by the compactors. Their office currently is located very well to oversee that MSW hopper. So the intent would be if we move the main office, then provide them a shelter in, you know, front and center, so they can oversee things. So yeah, okay. that's tied together with 12 and 13.
Okay. 15, swap shop and building containing miscellaneous recyclables and hazardous materials. The swap shop needs to have an attendant present during hours of operation. I don't know. I don't think we have the staff to do that, personally. But to make sure that hazardous, the recyclable materials are not left in the swap shop, is the swap shop to be located out of the way? But we did decide, didn't we, that we would have the swap shop and the hazardous materials on the same building with a firewall between?
And that's... The plan that you got in front of you shows them connected with the firewall. The plan that I've got with me tonight after we're done with this, I'll distribute that. It shows them next to one another with separation, so that not a firewall needed. So okay. Really, like I said before, it's the firewalls, the additional cost of the wall effectively may very well offset the you know, additional cost of two walls instead of one if we split the buildings.
Curtis,
On monitoring the swap shop, Would the towns be liable if there are volunteers? Got a lot of the swap shops we've gone to have volunteers that work in there. Just to keep a lot of junk that doesn't belong in there.
I would doubt that. I imagine we'd find a way to make that work.
Okay.
I think that the idea of the swap shop, although we couldn't do it if there's a wall, but we eventually, early we had two doors on either end, and then we could just go in with a skid steer and just throw stuff out. But I would... thing too, if it the swap with someone, I mean, people are, we have to tell people to be pretty careful what they put in there, but I would think bulleters almost should have a prayer meeting with anyone who puts something in there
that'll take care of
that doesn't belong there. Yeah, I mean, I just can't see people being that irresponsible.
They are.
I guess it happens.
Well, they are.
Is that a problem?
Yeah. There are signs all over the place, no air conditioners or dehumidifiers. Every week they're in there.
People just bring them in.
Yep.
Yeah.
This needs to be balanced with what we charge. We're talking pay as you throw and those type of things, and tightening up what we charge. After we visited Bark Hampstead, you know, there's certain fees. The more fees you charge, the more you're going to find stuff in the swap shop.
Yeah, you're right.
So,
yeah.
So this has to, I think this has to work in tandem with that. We have to have a balance because we don't want to charge more fees and then find that we're collecting the same fees and there's these big piles in a swap shop. So, you know, and we're going to, the sense is we want to tighten up on, you know, what we charge and how we charge it. So that has to be balanced. I agree. I don't know if a staff person is, Bark Hampstead, you know, makes $60,000 off the selling stuff out of the swap shop, but you know, that isn't us.
I don't see us doing that.
No,
I don't either.
No, and well, that's a track thing anyway. It's not.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. All we got to do is build it.
If the swap shop is, if it's close enough to where the people that are working there have, we're able to view it carefully and keep an eye on it. But we'll have to work on that one.
Yeah.
We'll have to see. We can spend a lot of time on that. I don't think we can answer it this second, but.
And that's, as far as I'm concerned, that's less of a concern for us.
Sure. Okay.
As far as location, as long as I'm providing the parking and the size of the building, after that's more for your discussion.
Right.
24 by 35 seems adequate to me. Anyone think that that's not good? Okay.
Is that for the swap shop and?
No, that's just the swap shop.
That should be accessible with a forklift? Yes. An easier method than we have now, because it's really, if you've all been there when they're trying to clear stuff out, it's right. It's clumsy, to say the least. So we need a better access, egress somehow to get in and out of there with a machine. Fire separation, yes. I think by code we're required to do that. So D would be, yeah, sure. E, hazard material building, and this would be oil, antifreeze, batteries, what else? Electronics?
Propane cylinders.
Propane.
And that building, that's a conversation that we can have specifically with Brian as far as how big does that building need to be to satisfy your needs. And then we can put that footprint on our plan.
And between the swap shop and the hazardous building, the hazardous materials building, if you have an outside gated with a cover, you don't need to have tires inside a building. You don't need to have propane inside the building. It can be outside but secured. And that also gives you separation between those two buildings.
That's right, concrete pad with the fence around it. Yeah. Yep.
Okay, and the feeling was that this should have a loading dock for a forklift? So to get things on trucks? I don't know, is that necessary?
Yes, you need to be able to access the back of that building so that when a vendor comes to pick up the materials, they're not parked directly in front of that building taking up all this. Doesn't need to be a loading dock that you can back up to, but there needs to be parking with a rear overhead door to get the forklift in and out.
Okay. So that can be level. It doesn't have to be an elevated pad.
Yeah, exactly. Kind of yeah. Good. Right. Dedicated
good.
Location
that's
for truck loading.
That's different than what I
would
do.
What would be the largest? Yeah, I was like, oh, man.
Oh, man. Big concrete
pad, elevated building lot. Yeah, that's easy.
No, good point.
G, the building should have a receiving area with a counter. Is this for oil and stuff, Brian? Is that what that would be?
So don't depend for air conditioners and all
yes.
those. Oh, I see. Okay. So you can unload something and it waist height and put it on something else and not bend over.
Back injuries.
Okay. And that's not a big cost thing.
And that's more, again, internal, where we are at this phase, as long as the building is square footage is big enough,
right.
That gets us through this conceptual level phase.
Yep. Yep.
16, bathrooms for staff and public need to be incorporated and separate. I hadn't thought about bathroom for the public. I just thought we had bathrooms for staff.
I was wondering about that. Is that a luxury we need? I mean, certainly for the staff.
They're not going to spend that long in the swap shop.
And I would say, you know, shower facilities as well for the staff. But I thought public restrooms are a luxury we just don't need to budget for.
You're not serving or selling food, so I don't think there's any obligation to have one.
No, it wouldn't be an obligation. It's a luxury item. Right. Many facilities will have, you know, effectively a non-signed bathroom, so that if you can direct the public there if need be. Right. But again, that's your preference.
Brian, what's the monthly need for that? Do you
near a couple dozen? Plus people are in there washing their hands after they spill stuff from their bottles and cans, or when they cut their hand and they need to wash it off.
The bathroom even for staff would be handicap accessible.
Yeah,
so do you think public bathroom or the washer?
We don't necessarily have to put one in, but if we do, it needs to be handicap.
Okay, Brian's talking more about people washing their hands.
Public and staff.
You could almost have some of those towels, or I don't know. It just seems to be as if it's over. But here we are, we're trying to watch costs. It just seems like
it could be common.
Yeah,
could it be both?
Make it large enough to be right. Common, accessible to both without interrupting Brian and his staff, but so the public has a way to access it without,
I just don't want us to take it off the table, because I think there is a need for it. But I don't know if we need two separate public.
I don't think we need two.
I think it's fine.
When I bring up things that are dirty, I bring gloves, and then if I bring oil, I usually bring up paper towels. Just wipe it.
Yeah, but you possess a large degree of common sense,
which we all know you can't legislate. So
right? Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Locker room needs to be incorporated.
Could that be attached right onto the bathroom?
Yeah, I would think. I mean, how many lockers do you need? Three, four, five, Brian? Do you think?
Yeah, we've got room for. How many people are you going to have there?
Yeah, okay. You know, that's a place to put things.
Yeah.
18, the A, the building needs to be moved to a lower level to avoid conflict with residents.
Yep,
oh, maintenance building, I'm sorry, I missed something.
And it was shown down once before, and based upon that conversation, we can relocate it back down there. It's just a cleaner, safer environment. We agree with that.
The idea is to position it close to the hopper to mitigate the reason why it's moved up, to bring it close to the utilities. So it'll move it back down, it'll be close to the hopper where the utilities will be there.
I think that makes sense. Good, okay, we're on the next page. Are we going too fast, too slow? All right.
You're rolling, Bill.
B.
My only parting comment is I'd always quietly assumed that the SSRRA would meet in alternating town halls and would not have to have a separate meeting place out there. But that's just my opinion. And they've never discussed it with anybody. But after all, this committee will be...
Watch the video camera.
Yeah. What's that?
Watch the video camera.
Oh, yeah. You want a picture of my front?
No, your arm almost got it.
Well, oh, were there plans? Maybe I missed that then. I mean, were we planning a meeting there? We were.
Well, that was one of the questions. That was Kevin's question.
Yeah, that's one of the questions.
Okay. All right.
Before you get out of buildings.
Yes, sir.
I have one thing I would like to go back to. At some point, we will probably want a conference room so that we can do an educational co-op with the high school, with the grammar schools, Hotchkiss and Salisbury, all of whom have expressed an interest. Hotchkiss will do a course there, recycling course. So somewhere in this plan, we should have a space at least for future.
I agree with that. Space, the funding may be outside of...
Hotchkiss may kick in. Salisbury may kick in.
But we ought to put it on the table.
Yeah.
So, but maybe not included in the budget.
Right.
So that, you know, the opportunity is there for somebody to step up to the plate and fund it. If it's not on the table...
One of the things we want to promote certainly is being green, because we are going to be green on this project. And if, I think making sure we have space for that, and hopefully that would be a donation through educators that would think that would be interesting and knowledge, have their kids, you know, learn those things. So
I don't expect it to be within this budget.
No. Okay.
Let's, I'll be clear with that.
Definitely not.
But
good.
Maybe
it sounds pretty big.
But,
good.
You know,
thanks. Good. Yes, that's right. And we have plenty of room up there for that.
Yeah.
I mean, we really do. Okay.
What we can do is show conceptual, you know, a
future.
A future.
Yep. Can be right adjacent to the main office or something, just a common room that
exactly.
can act
right.
as for that function.
Exactly.
Utilities, everything
would all be there.
Yep. Exactly.
So, it'd be easy. Public event.
That kind
public
of activity actually was occurring at CRRA the day we were there, right?
Yeah.
Yes. No, and we need to do that.
Most of the transfer stations have a setup for meetings for the school, you know, for the schools to come in.
Mm-hmm.
If we're going to cut down on what we use, we better train the next generation.
Well, my little niece the other day saw one of those plastic things go around soda bottles, cans. All these get in the water, they kill fish. You got to make sure, and she's only six. I mean, they learned at a young age. We're on that, the billing, I would think, if you think this is what it, we need, the two roll-off trucks, one forklift, backhoe, pickup truck, and possibly a skid steer. So if that's what we're going to need to garage, then that's what, obviously, the billing should be big enough, I would think.
And that's something that I got that specifically from Brian. So I'll look to Brian and say, when we're putting this together, provide us everything you need, and that's what we'll show at this time. So,
operations and maintenance, 19. The canopy should extend over the compactors and containers to keep snow off. Yes, I think that's a given.
Yep.
Got to do it.
You bet.
Right, we have to do that. 20. Open top containers need to be covered to avoid snow filling them up. I don't know, what Kevin, what normally what happens to those
Honestly, not many facilities cover their empty containers. That idea that we discussed, it makes perfect sense. Makes perfect sense. But I'll say that that would be one of the first items that we can put on the budget, but the budget's...
But they're not always empty.
Yeah.
That's going to go on a wish list.
We also have to, when we discussed it, we're talking about empty containers. We're also talking about full containers, and my concern, as we saw in Southington, and you see right at our transfer station today, you throw a lawnmower in there, and, you know, water gets in there, oil floats on water, out it goes. If that, we have bulky waste, construction demolition debris, which has lead paint in it. That container sitting there, we will cover, of course.
Yes.
But when it's full, waiting transport, there's also similar concern and exposure environmental.
How long do they sit there?
Well, usually not that long. But if you have a truck down and you're running one truck,
so it's something I wanted to put on the table.
Well, and we needed all we could do to not pollute. And
but I don't know what the answer is. Maybe
the additional closed containers need to be undercover, or you're back up on the roof, taking them, cleaning them off with the snow and ice.
We may need to go to a brush. Some of the truck stops or big truckers have some sort of a thing that brushes the snow off the top. They don't get out there and they don't cover. They can't.
Yeah.
So right. That might be an alternative to a lot of canopy.
All right, let's look into that one. 21, vehicle maintenance performed on site, and I think we save money doing that, don't we, Brian?
Preventive maintenance.
Preventive maintenance, yeah. Yes. And yeah, I think we should continue to do that. Anyone think I'm wrong, let me know. We should have fuel there. Can we move the tanks that we have, Brian, or we need different ones?
That was my question for you, Brian. Yeah. Are they suitable for moving?
Okay. Truck wash, and we all know, these trucks are a big investment. And in the winter, this salt, especially with a double frame, is a real problem, and it eats them up, and it costs us a fortune.
Getting
those trucks washed is important.
Could the building that contains them, and where the preventative maintenance number 21, mm-hmm. and the vehicle wash, all be the same building?
Yes.
Okay.
The idea would be to have the drive-through at one end, and then those two drive-through bays would also be your wash bays.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty simple.
And Brian,
it's a pressure washer as well.
What level are we talking? I mean, we've done just a handheld pressure washer, and the staff does it. That's
yeah. We're not talking automatic. Okay. Truck wash.
Okay.
A touchless car wash.
There's a car wash. There's a car wash just across the state line. You can go down there.
That's right. That's right. I don't think those trucks will fit in there.
This requires a special drain.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, we need a special drain for that, folks. So
yes.
Yeah. To eliminate, get rid of the salt.
So you're going to do the building anyway for preventive maintenance and storage.
Yeah.
So it's a question of adding the pressure washer and the drain and the containment.
Yeah, we have a pressure washer.
Okay, then you're talking about the... Yeah, so that's the additional cost.
Okay.
And you can tell us what that is when you get to it. Yeah.
And it seems to me as if it's a wise thing to do. I think we're going to get a bang for our buck on that and get our return on it.
We all see what salt's doing to cars, never mind.
It's time efficiency, too. If you've got to take staff to take time to take a truck to Salisbury or Sharon to do your wash, and then it's time out with the truck, it's time out with the man, it's not efficient.
Well, plus look at their schedules are crazy.
I can't see driving the forklift all the way to Salisbury just to wash it and then try to bring it back.
You get a lot of notice on the road. Yeah.
10 below zero. 24, sand storage, that's not a problem, I don't think. We just need to have a spot for it, correct?
That's something that I don't imagine you need a lot of it on site, so it's something that we could effectively, whether it's a hoop house or whether it's, a bunker, that's something that if you're maintaining that on site moving forward, that's something we can shop.
Could be a lean-to off the side of the maintenance building, something like that.
Yeah, well, you did mafia blocks and hoops for a lot of stuff.
That's what we have now.
The existing building that's on the property, I walked up and looked at that the other day. Part of the foundation is kicked out on the back side, but it's too low to get, I guess that we could use it for some kind of, but it's not within the kind confines of our operations, so.
It's not going to work with quite a way away.
Sit down the lot.
If there's a use to park something in there, fine, if not, it's just there.
Miscellaneous storage.
Until it falls down.
Right, yeah.
Right.
Then I can go and see if he.
Mattress storage. Do we need to, I thought there was a new law that when someone buys a new one, that they have to take the old one away. Isn't there some change?
I think there is, yeah.
Yeah.
You're buying new mattress.
Ryan's shaking his head, no.
Right.
No?
They're not required to take it back.
You have to pay for it when you buy a new one, the disposal part of it, that's all.
So what if you're just getting rid of?
How much square footage do you need for that?
Probably a roll off.
Are they going to require that?
So they can't get wet, right, Brad?
Not to have the, no, there's no mandatory requirement for anybody. But it would be their container on our site. We just need to have the space for it to be there.
Whose container is that? Some outfit that recycles them?
From the mattress product stewardship group.
So what you're talking about is a pad?
Right.
Concrete pad, so you got a concrete pad.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, actually, don't the furniture companies, when they sell them, they bring them to you anyways, the ones they pick up, right, Tom? No?
Okay, so that's not about they did.
Probably need one for carpet as well.
Or someplace with theirs, that we just bought.
In some towns.
Okay.
Okay, Joe, move on.
Okay, 26. A 10x10 MSW co-mingled hopper. They're not big enough, they need to be 12x12 or possibly 14x14. These hoppers need to have steep sides. So that items such as cardboard doesn't get lodged within them. Could you explain this someone to me so I understand it better?
As far as operationally, the steeper the sides, the larger the void, larger the opening, less material gets stuck in them. So
you also have more residual time.
Yeah.
When the container is being changed.
That's something we can do. And,
yep.
Okay.
Yep. That's something that with these hoppers, the larger they get, the more expensive they get. But if we need them, we need them. So it's just a function of doing business.
When you're at the transfer station, look at the slope of the hopper on the cardboard versus the MSW and see, and the capacity. And that goes down to one of the other numbers here. When it takes an hour to change out a box, you need the reserve capacity.
And the cardboard's getting jammed up twice a day now.
Okay. All right. So we don't need things blowing around either, so. Okay. Hoppers should be at 4 feet above finished grade. Along with future trailer access, along with roll-off access. And didn't you figure this into the plan? Didn't we do that?
This is something that we've talked about. The detail that's currently on the plan doesn't depict this. However, it's a matter of, currently we're showing an 8 to 10 foot grade change. That will wind up being a 12 foot grade change, effectively an 8 foot wall and a 4 foot push wall. What that also allows for is that in the future, if you do need to load out transfer trailers, you have that opportunity instead of being limited to roll-offs.
Okay.
So
the number I think you threw out.
Thanks, Tom.
Yeah, sir. I got $55,000.
Yep.
Okay. That's the number we're talking about. But also, if you go on to B on the next page, lifting them up gives them a push wall. We had a fairly lengthy discussion about how once you pull a hopper away, all this garbage falls down. What do you push against to load it? And now there's a wall there. And if we were to configure that, we talked about sometimes there's a ton of waste that falls on the ground. And they have to backblade it. So with that 4 foot height, we give you a push wall for them to push against.
Okay.
And manage that without having to
chase it around.
Yeah.
That's a yes.
Exactly.
That's common sense.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a yes.
And it gives you the flexibility of going back to a trailer should we ever have to go to a long haul.
Really, 1,000 to 2,000 pounds drops on the ground when you pull that thing away?
Yeah. The minimum you're going to do is 2 buckets for the backhoe.
Yeah,
can't
there's
do
a lot
six.
Of drops off there.
Yeah.
You got to watch it.
Yep. Yep.
And then you hear the cans and bottles at the same time.
You know what? We may get through this. We may get through
this. We will get through it.
28.
The glass is half full, though.
Increase access needs to be given to the commercial slots. 10 to 15 trucks a day back into MSW hoppers. Increase access. You mean a wider swing area? Is that what?
Yeah, the intent there was our plan has shown really limited access for just a few commercial haulers.
Mm-hmm.
What became apparent to us, that conversation we had with staff, is effectively it's not just the commercial haulers backing up to those hoppers.
Mm-hmm.
So the intent is that 10 to 15 pickup trucks a day, vans a day, and then along with 1 to 2 commercial trucks a day. So increased traffic flow requires more room, more maneuvering, huh?
And the other thing that we're talking about is moving some of the bulky over in the MSW, as Brian said, $20 a ton cheaper.
Yeah.
So there's, we may have more trucks over at the hopper that we're going to go more frequently, so that's another factor.
Okay.
That change that'll affect the design.
Yep.
Okay. 29, the recyclables dump off the sides of the trucks, is that something we can handle?
That's something that, again, we need to reconfigure. The current plan you have does not handle that. So revised plans will. That's something we discussed, we're comfortable with working with.
Okay, and the retaining walls around the compact need to be poured in place with heavy steel reinforcing, yes.
That's what we have.
This thing's got to have some integrity, otherwise it's going to fall apart, so. It's going to get banged up, no doubt about it. 31, retaining walls along with the bulky C&D metal containers need to be high enough so that a pickup truck can back up into the hip of its load straight into the roll-off. Maybe, could someone explain that, Brian?
I think when we made the statement as a committee, no backing, Kevin said, okay, you're not going to back up to the bulky. And that there was some miscommunication about what we meant, no backing. We have trucks backing up with shingle and everything else, and we're not going to expect them to throw it off. So that's that just clarifies that, yes, there's going to be backing.
It's going to be backing in that area. Effectively, that takes the wall from 5 feet to 8 feet. The top of the retaining wall would be effectively the top of the container. And then that also takes us down to number 32, as far as providing within that fall protection handrail a gated access into the containers that we foresee needing dumping.
Okay.
So that you could open the gates, back a truck up, tip it, close the gates as it pulls away. Okay. So those go hand in hand.
So that handles 32 then also, right?
Yes.
Great difference between the 12-foot.
Would that need to be a sliding gate then, Kevin, so that you're not trying to swing gates out over the container or back toward a truck?
Honestly,
just
that's
for ease.
No. It would make sense if the less time that gate is open, the better. So
that's
slide gate would function better. However, it's going to be more expensive, and honestly, I don't think it would be needed. It's something in this case. Ideally, what we'd like to see is an attendant there opening the gate or closing the gate, so that those slide gates don't get left open. If there's a truck coming in, you swing the gate open. As the truck leaves, you swing it closed. Slide gates would be nice, but honestly, they're going to get hit once, and then they're never going to work well again. So, added cost that I don't think would really be needed.
Swing gates are good.
I thought that's what you said anyway, didn't you?
That's exactly what I said. Long conversation for nothing.
34, yes. Let's reuse the compactors. If we need to redo the controls, we have to do them, because those are expensive, and they're rebuilt, we have to use them. Yes, Brian.
I'd just say it's not necessarily correct.
Oh,
the
thank you.
The old hopper is, I don't know, 1970 something, and the newer one is 1995. The newer cardboard hopper has had a new motor put in the last 2 years. The garbage hopper has had had the pistons rebuilt, but the motor and the hydraulic, it's all, I don't know when that was last done.
Well, then we shouldn't be penny wise, pound foolish. We got to look, analyze what shape they're in, and make a decision.
Well, the cardboard one is supposedly portable.
Okay.
So
maybe one out of two.
Right.
I think the power unit hydraulics are, you unplug them, you put a new one, so they can get us a cost on the power unit for the new. It's a 30 horse motor. And,
to be purchasing these units new, the compactors are $28,000. The hoppers are $16,000. So if we can use the hoppers and compactors we have. But we can get a price on what it would cost you to refurb them.
Mm-hmm.
We can weigh that against the cost estimates we have on new.
Great. Worth it. That's good. That's something we just got to make a business decision on.
Better than sliding gates.
36. MSW containers are filled daily and commingled, or filled three times a week. An average Sunday will generate 20 yards of commingled material. Okay. Based on 37, based on recent site visits for other facilities performed by staff, it appears to staff that the existing station may be understaffed during certain busy periods. And I guess what, Sundays you mean, Brian?
No, just throughout the day. If there's only one person on site, they're busy doing a lot of different things. And there's a lot of people doing things that you can't see what they're doing.
All right, I think we should have a policy, and this is not building committee, but...
Yeah, this is an issue for us.
We need more than one person on site.
Move on.
The last item, two existing compactors currently accept MSW and co-mingled material. It's a little 75-foot trailer. Utilize compactors, what, let me see, the grade change. Okay, the wind did a grade change.
Just further clarification from the grade change we discussed.
Okay, great job, Bill.
Can you repeat that?
We try to hold these to an hour if we can, and especially with Bob Sweeney coming up next.
Last three.
Kevin? Kevin, did I cut you short? Go ahead.
Nope, I've got plans to distribute that incorporate a lot of these changes. This is just conceptual. It's something that I've got a dozen copies and one large. I can hand them out. I don't know what time it is. I can not talk about them, or we can talk about it next time. You can mull them over. You can email me comments, whatever works best for you.
We don't have a track quorum, so...
Well, let's, then, is it okay with you if we do go through these?
Sure.
Okay.
Take that large one. Let's set it somewhere somewhere.
Chip one, Bob. Chip one, Bob.
Me too.
I can fix that.
All right, what we're looking at there is, again, just a conceptual sketch incorporating a lot of the items that we went through with staff as far as a reconfiguration of, primarily reconfiguration of those MSW and co-mingled hoppers. Now, the intent there is to use two new and the two existing. Now, what this shows, there's a label there that says commercial truck access. That's one concept that allows those commercial trucks enough room to move around, back up, pull onto the driver's side, do whatever they need to do in that area. Now, one conversation we had the other day was effectively, are we trying to do too much in too small of a space? As we start putting, you know, two compactors and then putting a third row off and then trying to get everybody into that one central location. So what this begins to show is lengthening that wall and spreading out those MSW and co-mingled hoppers so that there's enough room for residents to pull in. Now, those drive lanes show approximately 7 parking stalls. So 7 people can pull right up along those compactor hoppers, and then you've got 12 spaces on the other side. No island, effectively. It can be striped, it can be painted, it can be, you know, coned off if you need be, or whatever you need in that area. But that shows what we're beginning to do is open up the pavement area there and provide more room at the top. What this also shows is a much reduced canopy area. That canopy went from 40 feet wide to 24 feet wide. Effectively, a conversation that Bob and I had was trying to remove some of the, you know, some of the comfort items, some of the...
What are we going to say by reducing that money-wise?
If, on the previous plan, let's ignore the plan in front of you. On the previous plan, if you reduce all the canopies over the drive aisles, it's approximately $140,000. Now, that's right off the ball. You know, those drive aisles are, like I said to you last time, more of an ATM window idea, where those drive aisles covered, those canopies cover the drive aisle. 24 covers the compactor and covers the box. Or excuse me, covers the hopper, the compactor, and the box. That's all that needs to be covered. Now, that $140,000 savings goes a long way as far as getting a wash bag and getting some of the other stuff in here that, you know, based upon staff, is really more germane to keeping the operation functioning as far as trucks on the road and residents in and out quickly.
Okay.
Now, this configuration that you have in front of you, you know what? There is more canopy here than on the previous plan, based upon the lengthening of those walls.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Everything here grows a little bit, and this is the trend every time I come up, the plans that we're showing you grow a little bit from the previous. There hasn't been a time that we've been charged with starting to reduce.
Yet.
That will be coming.
I mean, some of the reduction ideas, there is, you know, every drive aisle on this plan before you is a 24-foot wide drive aisle. That's as wide as a local road. You don't need those widths throughout this entire station at all locations. You know, some of those opportunities could very well be to say, you know what, take this pavement and reduce it by 10%. Pinch everything in a little bit. And those become the ideas that we'll have when we enter the conversation about starting to pull back. But this plan shows the large equipment building down below, drive-through access, and access all the way around the building as well. What it does not show is the spare containers being under a cover, but obviously that is something we can put a price to, and if it maintains, then it's something we can show. And when we move up top, the swap shop, and along with the recycled material storage, those buildings would have truck access on both sides. The leaf storage bunkers, or the bunkers, have been reduced from 3 to 1. We could, you know, obviously, when you're looking at the plan on the left-hand side, there is more room for more bunkers, but again, trying to take into consideration some of the items that we talked about with staff, some of the items that we talked about on the site visit, that existing vegetative screen over by the barn has been reduced by half. So we're taking advantage of that high, flat area, reduce that screening area, and generally try to make things more compact at the top of the site, reducing some of the fill, you know, that fill envelope.
Okay.
That area, as far as the main office, that can be shifted around, but what I did do was show the stair more inbound to the site, trying to reduce that length of the drive, making it feel like this, making it feel like that the facility is actually behind those trees rather than pulling itself out to Millerton. Bringing that scale on site also allows more, you know, circular, you know, movement on site with the office in the middle, so you can see people coming and going off that scale rather than it being, you know, out in the, you know, out on the beginning of the access drive. All these areas can be moved around, tweaked. This is really just a concept to get us started thinking about the ideas that we discussed with staff. The predominant one would be that commercial truck access and the addition of those two additional, or those two extra hoppers and compactors. Like I said to you before, each one of the compactors is $28,000, the hoppers are $16,000. So if we're purchasing new, that's a substantial increase from what we had shown before. But if we're moving two more, you know, if we're moving out two over to here, you know, like you said, that's a business decision. One item at the sidewalk that came up that I didn't have an answer to was how much physical area, you know, acreage-wise, we're looking at here. Based upon the existing, within the existing tree clearing, when you were out on site, the limits of those trees that we're talking about is 4 acres.
Okay.
Right now, we're using 3 of those acres on this plan that you have in front of you.
And I think our current site is 2.
Okay. Great. There's a lot of, you've done some homework.
That's a whole lot of information here. What my hope was to do was put it on paper, give it to you guys, and say this is as far as we're comfortable going at this point before we need more conversation as far as where to go from here.
This is great. Let's all make sure we do some homework, study this during this next month, and get with me or Bob or one of us or Charlie and funnel information. We can give information back to you if we have additional thoughts.
That would be great. We can talk about this further. We can also put some pricing on this plan for the next meeting, or anything else that you task me with, we can move forward with. So.
One quickie, what about parking for staff?
Parking for staff? The maintenance building down below, I would foresee having a substantial staff parking down there. When we start talking bathroom facilities, the leaching system, the test pits that we were standing on at that sidewalk, in that general location of the maintenance building. So that would be where the leaching field would be. It would make sense if there were staff bathrooms down in that building, and therefore staff parking, and possibly even the locker rooms and so forth, could be down in that building, and rather than up at the main office.
Yes, Bob.
Track this afternoon, we'll possibly set a date to meet with haulers to talk about changing to unit or bond-based pricing and the single stream recycling, we'd also invite it, if the committee wants to, is to sit down with the haulers and move with this plan to get their input like we did with staff.
Sounds like a good idea to me.
So you want us to let you know what that is? Because you can see the staff's input was valued. And the haulers likewise are feet on the ground.
Okay. In all fairness to Bob's group, who they're all, he has a forum, I'm sure, at this point. But before, any questions? Anyone have anything on his or her mind? Any questions from Ann? Anything in public? Any comments? Great. And thank you, everybody, for getting here.
Nope.
Need a motion to adjourn.
I've got one additional.
Meeting adjourned.